The following AIB Presents contains adult content that some viewers may find disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
It is a form of modern-day slavery. Children bought and sold for sex every day in Georgia.
It's so violent, it's so ugly. We don't believe that humans could do this to each other.
300 to 500 preteen and teenage girls bought and sold in Georgia each month. The average age, 12 to 14. The numbers for boys, unclear, but likely comparable.
People are finally starting to understand that it doesn't just happen out in Africa or in some foreign country. It's going on here in Atlanta and all over the United States, and there's no denying it.
It is fed by industries, say advocates, that contribute to a mindset that tolerates it.
I think when you look at specifically pornography in strip clubs, you're looking at really the epitome of that devaluing, where all the human worth is what it does for me.
And it's nursed in a culture that all but supports it.
Why are we so shocked that our young boys think this way? If we look at what's on television, if we look at what's in the hip-hop music, what's in the rap music, and it's not just music that black people listen to, it's not just the hip-hop. It's ingrained in every type of media that we have out here. Even when you just look at shows as simple as Dancing with the Stars, it makes you, as a young person or as a young woman, look at what is beauty? What does my body have to look like? What do I have to do to get some type of attention or notoriety? And everything challenges their thinking.
It's all but born where children should feel safest.
And we look at 1 in 4 girls and 1 in 6 boys are sexually abused before they're 18 years of age. Only 1 in 10 will ever tell. And 93% are abused by someone they know, love, and trust. So the abusers are not the 7% are the stranger danger that we teach our children about.
In this edition of AIB's look at DMST, domestic minor sex trafficking, we explore the factors that fuel the industry and those that fight it. Trafficking children for sex is a crime that investigators and prosecutors alike report being under-resourced to investigate and prosecute, hindered in large part by those who don't and must understand how widespread and complex it truly is.
From an awareness and a prevention standpoint, that's the only way it's going to end. Like any other industry, there's a supply and a demand.
To prevent its escalation, advocates say, reach potential victims when they're still considered at risk.
Those girls look just like the victim. And the only thing that's different between the two is the time. Because right now, she's vulnerable, she's high risk extreme, she is being sexually exploited, she has unhealthy adult relationships, the lines are blurred, she's self-parenting, she's not going to school, she's running away from home, mom can't care for her, and then boom, we are waiting until she runs away for a period of time, and then she shows back up 6 months later, and now she's running from a pimp.
But evidence of child sex trafficking may appear invisible. Marshall Ransifer, community activist, knows what that's like firsthand.
You know what I remember most about my time out on the streets is how people looked at me and how they treated me. You know, and I imagine these kids and other sex workers go through the same thing, and transgender folks go through the same thing I went through. People looked at me like I was trash, like I wasn't anything, that I had no value.
It is a pain few can comprehend. Mary Frances Boley founded Wellspring Living, which offers trafficked girls a safe haven and healing.
A 14-year-old is the average age of those who are being bought and sold right tonight. Tonight, there are 100 girls that are going to be sold in the metro Atlanta area. It's just intolerable to think about that. And I think that's where we have to go to the brutal facts, and then how am I going to move forward from that? One of the things that broke my heart whenever I found out about the stories of the girls, I cannot tell you about the 100 that are out there, but I can tell you about the girls that walked through our doors. Most of them have had multiple abortions before they walk in. In fact, our, and they're not by choice either, our therapist said that most girls have had an average of 8 abortions before they come in our doors. Are you kidding? I mean, that's just a health risk, number one, besides everything else. Most of them, they say 8 to 10 times a night. We know that it's been up to 20 times a night. You hear, well, they're locked up. Sometimes they are. Many of our girls have been locked in closets with 3 or 4 other girls for the day, and they come out at night. Most of them are not fed well. They'll have something slipped under their door. They're drugged. I mean, we have to have a substance abuse class for our girls because they didn't choose drugs, but the pimp, the perpetrator did. That's how he kept business going. He kept them going with meth and other things so that he could make more money off of them.
If only more people could recognize the signs and report what they see, says Chanel Smothers of Living Water for Girls, an organization that offers a safe house and training for young women rescued from the street.
One of the things that you can look for is if you have a very young person with an older person. Now that, you know, my niece will sometimes go and hang out with my father. And just watching the way that they interact. There is a way that a grandparent interacts with a grandchild that's very different than the way that a pimp interacts with someone that they're exploiting. And so I think there are times when people will see a couple and think, something's just not right there. There's just something about the way that child makes eye contact with no one else that just doesn't fit. And so when you see things like that, if you see a young lady or young man that's not adequately dressed for cold weather, so, you know, it's 50 or 45 degrees outside, and she's got a mini skirt on, a bra top, lots of makeup, and obviously not older than 18, red flags should go off.
The plight of foreign-born women trafficked for sex in Georgia is complicated by cultural differences, says Laura Carter of the group Tapestry.
Learning to recognize that they are not at fault. I think that's one of the biggest things. A lot of them are very apologetic. A lot of them blame themselves a great deal. Just saying that, you know, I should have known better. I can't believe I fell for that. You know, I should have left when I knew. But in reality, a lot of times they couldn't leave. Maybe due to cultural reasons, they couldn't leave the man even though he was abusive, because maybe in their culture it would be a very large stigma for them to leave a man if she's married, or to not marry a man if she's had sexual relations with him. So she could become ostracized from her community if she did that. She could ostracize her family for doing that and give them all a bad name.
The facade of the sex for pay industry hides a reality that Casey McClure understands all too well.
I'm very passionate about helping these girls get out of the life because I came from the life. My sister was in the life for 21 years. I was in the life for 5.5 years. And even though it made me a lot of money, at the end of the day, I knew it was wrong. When you have married men coming in there and you just have all the girls that are strung out, not every girl, but they're girls that are become alcoholics, become drug addicts, just to deal with, you know, being a stripper or being a prostitute. And I'm very passionate about it because a lot of these girls come from abusive homes, were sexually abused. As I was, sexually abused by my father and a couple other people along the way, but mostly my father made the biggest impact because he was supposed to be my father. And instead, he, you know, was molesting me, my sister, and it traumatizes you, and it opens up doors to, so when you go become a stripper, that it's okay. It's like it's no big deal that you're a stripper. When a young girl that's 18 decides to become a stripper, she goes into the club very naive, and the guys welcome her in because they love the fresh girls, the new face, the young girl, the next girl, you know, the girl next door look. She comes in there and she starts getting comfortable in the club. And she might make money in the beginning because she's new, but once she's been there a year and she starts drinking more, she starts partying more, eventually that's gonna catch up with her. And then one night she doesn't make money and she needs to pay her, her phone bill or her rent the next day, and a gentleman walks in and says, I know you need to make this money tonight. Do you want to meet me at my hotel room? And then that girl makes the decision to go with him. And the next thing you know, she's prostituting herself for money. It's a fine line. And a lot of girls think, oh, well, I'm just a stripper. I will never do that. But you never know when that opportunity opens up.
And don't ignore them after trafficked teens turns 18, says Jeff Shaw with Out of Darkness.
People feel a natural compassion for kids, but those kids turn 18 at some point. And the question is, on their 18th birthday, do they become less worthy of our concern or our compassion or our help? Because all those same wounds are there. All that stunting of the emotional and relational development is there. That lack of education is there. That lack of self-worth is there. So even when you can be talking about a 43-year-old, we helped a woman who was 59 years old. And she was abused starting as a child. So she's still, if you've never resolved those wounds and those issues and that trauma, that person is still has that same need. And so, yeah, with most of the women we've worked with, the trauma has occurred in the childhood and the formative years.
Out of Darkness reaches out to and rescue girls and women from the street.
There is one rescue that we had. It was a young woman in Savannah. And when we picked her up, she was 29 years old. She looked like she could have been in her 40s just because of all that she's endured. Her body was not holding up well, but she acted like a 13-year-old. So you're looking at a woman who looks very old. She's actually a young adult, and she acts like a child. And she sat in the back. The way she talked, like just her tone of voice, the words she used. We've had women suck their thumbs, hold teddy bears, lay in the lap of the female volunteer and say, will you play with my hair? Will you scratch my back? I mean, it's that just complete void of affection that a child needs growing up for healthy development that they've never received. And so that doesn't leave when they turn 18, that follows them into adulthood.
Jennifer Swain of Youth Spark says the lure of the life and what might at first seem like love must be addressed head on, she tells at-risk girls she works with.
Nobody in this room is that fine, that you so fine that a 31-year-old wants you. There's nothing that he should want from you. And no matter how mature you are, no matter how old you've been allowed to act, no matter how much weed you smoke, no matter how much you drink, no matter how much people have violated your body and your personal space, you are not an adult. And you don't need to act that way with someone else. And that is what we work with them on, because they don't get it. When you've been made to act as an adult, you've been allowed to self-parent, it's really hard for you to act like a 14-year-old again, you know? And that is what I hope people can begin to realize. There is this normal walking around us. And if we don't understand that there are isolated incidents of exploitation that lead to the big heinous cases, then we need to stop waiting to rescue them, and let's work and be proactive in prevention.
A deeper issue, stop glorifying perpetrators.
Even, 50 Cent's song PIMP, which is Billboard platinum album, millions of copies sold. He talks about whether it's hot out or whether it's freezing, she gets on her knees for me, just for some Mickey D's, that's the rhyme. So he's like, all I gotta do is buy her McDonald's and she'll go out and do what that's become a part of our society that we celebrate. The song It's Hard Out Here for a Pimp won a Grammy for best, or is either a Grammy or an Oscar for best song in a movie. And the guys went up and everybody's giving them standing ovation, and what a joke, right? It's hard out here for a pimp. Well, what does he do? Well, how is it then for the girls that he's abusing and exploiting, right? So really, I think it's great to do outreach. It's great to rescue. It's great to restore. But as a culture, we have to at some point say it's not acceptable to commodify and objectify anybody. And particularly what we're seeing is the objectification of women, because men exert this power and this strength over them. And if there's nobody that says no, or nobody who cares or steps up to stop, it's just going to continue. So again, Just like pornography, I want to be fair here. Not everybody who looks at pornography is going to be out looking for someone to buy sex with. But I would challenge you to find someone who's gone out to buy sex that didn't first look at pornography or didn't first go to the strip club. Because at some point, if you can look at another human being as only being worth what they can do for you, then where's the line in that?
It's a line that some say should be drawn in everyday conversation, particularly among men. Stuart Griffin is with Street Grace, a coalition of worship communities fighting child sex trafficking.
There's a term called the bystander effect. It's really not, it doesn't really, you know, when a lot of people hear that, they think of when they see something illegal, like someone, you know, beating someone else or taking part in violence or an illegal activity. It actually refers more to when you see something or hear something that you know deep down isn't right. Like maybe someone, your buddy's talking about or making fun of someone because of the color of their skin or because of just the way they look in general or their faith. And the bystander effect really just says, what do you do about that? How do you approach that? And we want to teach men that when they're in those, you know, situations, the locker room type situations, or on the golf course, or, you know, sitting down at a meal, and another man begins to talk about a subject that isn't appropriate, you know, whether that's about prostitutes, strippers, just objectifying women in general, how to stand up and say, hey, you know what? I appreciate that you think that's okay, but I don't. And it's just a way to constructively get men to engage other men in that way. And I think that we would find that a lot of men don't even like to talk that way. But it's the way they're brought up. It's the way that they're told they need to talk in order to be a man. And we need to change that. I mean, I know I don't accept it anymore. And I'm hoping that a lot of other men will follow that.
Georgia's Not Buying It campaign also targets men. And a Street Grace web-based initiative called FACE urges 7,200 men to sign a pledge against child sex trafficking.
FACE stands for Fathers Against Child Exploitation. It really is built on the basis that since men are predominantly the ones responsible for purchasing children for sex, then they have to get involved in the solution. That doesn't necessarily mean we're out there targeting the men who are doing this and asking them to turn their lives around. What we're doing is asking men in general to start a different kind of conversation. That conversation is about protecting women and protecting children. And I think something that's really been lacking in our society. Definitely not saying that they should follow my example or I'm perfect. I believe it's just a time to say, okay, well, I've made mistakes in my past. I've objectified women. I've used them in a way that they're not created for, and we need to ask more men to say, okay, I'm going to stop now and learn to do it differently. So we're engaging men in that conversation, and we're giving them resources to do so, and then we're teaching them in a really wonderful way, leveraging some great web-based technology, how to engage the next generation. You look at it from a father-son perspective. And we're not asking you to be a father in order to be a member of Fathers Against Child Exploitation. We're doing this under the notion that all men are fathers. All men are protectors. Whether you have a biological child or not, and whether you agree with that or not, because it's just the truth. I believe, and the people involved in the project believe, that all men, and then just as humans, we're called to protect one another, not just men versus women. So, a component of that is, how do we get men to constructively talk to their sons so we stop perpetuating that? And then how do we get men interested in mentorship?
And kids need tools too, including web-based games and adults who speak with them, not to them, to learn before it's too late. Jennifer Swain.
And that's what we want to do at Youth Spark, is be a movement of not just adults, but adults and children alike. Youth, we want them at our table. We don't want to talk about them anymore. We want to talk with them. And then we want to work to end trafficking through prevention. We got law enforcement trained. We got the governmental agencies on board. We got churches on board. People are signing petitions. They'll donate. Now it's time for us to be proactive in prevention so that we can look up and just 12 years is not far away. 10 years is not far. So we can get to the 10-year-olds now so that when they grow up, they would never be a buyer. Because what we know from our Georgia demand study is that men who purchase sex, they're going to do so repeatedly, probably. So I'm not saying to skip over them and let them, you know, die and go off into the gates of hell. I'm saying that we can go and get the young boys now who are 10 and begin to educate them appropriately, change their mindsets, change the way that they view women. And we have to challenge what they get on media and the games. In these video games, if we don't challenge those things and use the same tools, put the same power behind it, then we're missing the mark. And if we can go that far and get them to grow up and never become a buyer or a pimp, we want boys to grow up and never become a victim either. We want girls to know that you don't have to be that bottom bitch. You don't have to be that bottom girl. You don't have to be that pimp. You don't have to be that victim. Imagine what kind of community and society we'll live in just a few short years. And that is the way we look at our trafficking movement at Youth Spark right now.
And while kids need to be educated, adults must learn to be comfortable with what for some are taboo topics. Angela Williams of Voice Today advocates and educates to eradicate child sexual abuse.
Coach adults, so these conversations need to start at age 2 in identifying a child's anatomical names to their body parts, in identifying when and where their private parts should be touched. For health and hygiene are the only reasons that someone should be touching your private parts. Layering those conversations throughout a childhood, layering those conversations about possible threats, potential threats, letting them know that every person in your life may not be safe, then what we can begin to do is build a society and a community where if a child is threatened or there is some risk, then they have a safe person to go to, that a safe person that they can trust. And perhaps if there's intervention at a young age, if a child's sexually abused at 5 or 7 or 8 and they know that they can disclose and they're believed and there's intervention and they get justice, perhaps they're not that 11, 12, and 13-year-old that's running away, getting off of a Greyhound bus in downtown Atlanta and within 48 hours are solicited into commercial exploitation.
The solution requires a holistic approach, say advocates, stiffer penalties for buyers, a so-called mandatory John School, and safe harbor legislation recognizing that children in prostitution are not criminals, but victims and need specialized services in trafficking and sex abuse cases.
I think that our law enforcement and legal system and our judicial system is letting our children down. I think that we have to reduce the burden of proof when it comes to a child who is disclosing sexual abuse. So often there's not physical evidence. So often the child has been so intimidated and so manipulated and groomed, and they live in such a place of fear that you can't get the type of disclosure that really a court system is looking for. And so often the child can be easily discredited in a court of law. Easily discredited. So therefore, that perpetrator walks away and continues the behavior. So you have this vicious cycle of sexual abuse that continues. We have a society that really looks the other way, even in the cases where it's exposed a child has been sexually abused or a child is being trafficked. There's a society in a sense of there's just not that sense of repulse or activism that needs to take place to protect that victim. There seems to be more sympathy or more compassion almost for the perpetrator. And that's sad. And that sends a message to our children that we really don't care and it really is okay for you to be sexually abused.
And even when girls have the support, challenges remain. Casey McClure.
It's very hard sometimes to get the girls, once they leave the lifestyle, to stay away because you constantly have to, I don't want to say baby them, but be there for them. And sometimes they're just going to battle with it. They're going through financial stress, emotional stress, and some people can't handle it. And a lot of times if they have drug addictions, it's even harder. So we do have girls that have gone through programs, completed programs, been clean, been away from this life, and then they're released from the program. and then they find themselves back in this life. So it isn't just because they go to a program and graduate a program doesn't mean that it's over with. This is a lifelong process because once they've been exposed to that life, it is so hard to keep them on the right track because they can really fall prey again.
It takes a community and a hands-on approach, says Marshall Ransifer, community activist.
A lot of days when I'm out there on those streets doing this work, I'm the only person I ever see out there trying to help these folks. And I guess that's the hardest part of doing this work, is that a lot of times I feel like I'm by myself. You know, because most people, you know, they get together and have all these meetings, but actually seeing folks out there trying to do something to help is far and in between. And that's the biggest issue I have with this problem, is it's not enough people out there on the streets actually trying to engage these people.
Action that Atlanta and Georgia must take, claim advocates, if there is a commitment to severing the pipeline that puts Georgia children at risk on the internet and on the street. Mary Frances Bowley of Wellspring Living.
You have to think about them being branded like cattle. And we're okay with that. You know, I don't know how to bring the action out. I just feel like we just got to keep talking. We got to keep talking. Somebody somewhere is going to help pull this to the top. Don't even know who that could be. And maybe it's not just a one person. Maybe it's all of us speaking out. And together, we come up with some way of making a difference. And quite frankly, I think it's going to happen out of Atlanta. Atlanta and Georgia has been the leader in this issue. We may not be leading in a lot of things, but we're leading in this issue. So I'm not going to be surprised if something doesn't bubble up from Atlanta that's going to change our nation.
A change that will require knowing the signs, paying attention, and knowing that day in and day out, Atlanta's children face unspeakable violations, bought and sold for sex, because all too often, people look the other way. To find out how you can help, contact the following organizations. AIB will also post the list at www.aibtv.com. Street Grace, streetgrace.org, and the FACE Initiative at faceatlanta.org. Youth Spark at youth-spark.org. Living Water for Girls, www.cofcl.org. WellspringLiving.org. Tapestry at tapestri.org. Outofdarkness.org. VoiceToday.org. And NotBuyingIt.org. And if you see something suspicious, contact the National Anti-Trafficking Hotline, available 24/7 at 1-888-373-7888.